So I'm going to talk about today, what does it mean to be connected in the 21st century? Sophocles once said that nothing vast enters the life of mortals without a curse. So I think that technology today would certainly fall into that curse part, as well as great potential. I was recently in New York, and everyone was looking down when they were walking down the street. Remember in New York, you normally bump into people and you have these exchanges, and that's what's so great about New York. Well, everyone was texting, everyone's head was down, and I half expected to see the Statue of Liberty like torch in one hand and kind of texting that tablet with the other hand, which is kind of the way I feel like so much of our interactions are these days. I think the first time that we're connected is in the umbilical cord. We're connected in the womb to our mother, and we're getting all this data from the blood and the genetic information from our parents. The doctor cuts that cord, and we're in the world, and we spend the rest of our lives trying to connect to something greater than ourselves, whether that's religion or community, and now we have all these tools like technology to connect to something larger than ourselves. And certainly with Twitter and email and Facebook, we're only becoming more and more inundated with all this connective tissue. I personally love technology. I'm addicted to the speed of it. I'm the one of the early adopter. I want to get everything when it first comes out and play with it and test it. So although I'm going to have somewhat of a critical eye today on what technology is doing to us all, I'm also a big passionate supporter of technology and completely, completely addicted to it. When I was in high school, I started this, my brother who's here in the audience with me, we had a little Apple IIe, we even had, I think, the Lisa, and we were total nerds and we'd play with the computers all the time. And my family is from, our grandparents are from the Soviet Union. And I had this other family, a friend whose family was from Iran, and this was the 80s, and they were like the enemy country at the time. So we wrote this proposal that talked about uniting students in the Soviet Union and Iran and America together in the 80s to bring about world peace. Of course, back then, not many people had personal computers, and so it kind of bombed as an idea. But it was definitely my first real kind of foray into thinking about technology as a way to connect the world for this, for a global conversation. I then founded the Webby Awards in the mid-90s, and I spent about a decade of my life focused on what the web could, how the web was changing the world, and what were the best practices in the web, and how to push it forward by honoring people, say, like, this is the best, and hopefully have people, like, propelled to push beyond that. And now I spend all my time making movies, and I'm working on this film called Connected, which is all about the subject of what does it mean to be connected in the 21st century. So I definitely wrestle with how much I use technology. I'm definitely multitasking too much. I am totally addicted to Twitter. Our father was a surgeon, and we used to go watch him operate, and he'd had this myopic focus. He would just be looking at what he was operating on and just be like, to the nurse, this 8 hours straight. Nothing else was in his purview but what he was doing. Now, if you looked at the way that I work, I've got like 20 files opened on my desktop. I'm tweeting 70, right? 70, I've got, you know, my multiple phones and Twitter and everything, and I, you know, moving from thing to thing. And sometimes I'm like, God, I'm so distracted. I'm such a distracted multitasker. And then other times I think, well, maybe we have finally created a work environment that mirrors our stream of consciousness, because we don't think in a linear way. Like, you're all sitting here looking at me and you're thinking, I gotta pick up my daughter, I gotta go pick dinner, I'm listening, I'm thinking of something else. Our minds are not linear by nature. So have we finally created a work environment that is actually mirroring our stream of consciousness? So like, our brains couldn't grow any larger than, like, you know, pound and a half at birth, and so we like created these extensions, these brains on our desks and now in our pockets and now in the ether. But yet I, you know, my husband and I, we're constantly trying to turn off technology when we're with our kids. I mean, like, kids are the, besides the fact if they're grabbing your iPad because they want to play with it, but kids are all about being in the present. You know, it's like, sit down, let's look at the butterfly, or let's just play Tickle Monster on the floor, or, you know, it's all about being in the present. And so we really try to take technology Shabbats and, like tonight, sundown, try to turn it off, turn off the cell phone for a day, and it's really hard. It's really hard, but we really try to do it. Every week we try, and we fail a lot of the time. But a lot of the time, we get a little itchy, but we do it, and it's actually great. I mean, when's the last time any of you have unplugged for a day? Oh, my God, that was one hand. How'd it feel? It's great, right? Your mind thinks in a different way. You're not getting all that stimulus and that input, and as wonderful it is to get all that, you know, have access to all that data and information, it's also really, you forget how... you think differently when you're unplugged, and there's real value to remembering what that feeling is like. So, you know, Thomas Friedman, he talked about that we're living in the age of distraction. And Nicholas Carr came out with a book that was talking about the shallows, that we don't do any deep dives on information anymore, that we're just skimming the surface. And, you know, back in the 50s, Hitchcock used to say a film should only be long as your bladder holds. And you know, TED Talks are only supposed to be 18 minutes, 10 minutes. And Twitter's like 140 characters. Like, what direction are we going in? Like, pretty soon, like, how long can we really say an idea? What will we be allowed to speak? How quickly will it have to happen? So I really believe that the web and the internet and all this technology is rewiring our brains. There is absolutely no doubt that it is rewiring our brains. I mean, I used to be that person when I went out to lunch with people. I would be like, cell phones on the table, just like in a Western. Like, put your fucking cell phone down and don't turn it on. And I used to be that person, like, don't turn it on. But now, I put it on the table, but I leave it on. And it becomes like this ticking bomb. Like, if I'm not quite stimulated enough or interested enough, I'll have to check my phone. Oh, like, there's a phone call, there's a text, there's an email. Or I've even been known to, on occasion, fake going to the bathroom to, how many of you have ever done that? Yes. So it's truly changing our whole social dynamics. I also used to smoke for many years. I quit over 12 years ago, but I have that same feeling. I have that feeling like, you know, sometimes I'd be smoking, and as I was smoking, I'd want another cigarette. I actually had that feeling sometimes. Sometimes I'm tweeting and emailing, and I need another email. It's like it's tapping into that same biological fix. And actually, I did some research, and it does. So... when you're, so oxytocin, let's skip ahead here. Actually, first, let me go to some dopamine, because that's very interesting. So dopamine is, basically, it's the hormone that is released for basically sex, drugs, and rock and roll, you know, for things you want, sex, food, pleasure. That's what makes you want it again and again. So they just did a study that dopamine is also released when you seek information. So you're getting that same hit when you're on Google. So I thought that's very interesting. And then I was doing this other study. So it's like oxytocin, which is, you know, it's the hormone that is released when you're touched and when you connect with someone. And new mothers are flooded with it. And it's when it makes you feel less fearful. It makes you feel happy, empathetic, generous, more trusting. That's what you feel with the social networking. I think that's where that addiction comes from, is you're getting this oxytocin hit. So it's almost like all of these social networks are creating these like infinite pathways for all these new triggers of oxytocin on this global level. So if you take that to the nth degree, while people might think that social networking might be trivial, it's not. It's like creating this new infrastructure for oxytocin on this global level for potential huge collaboration if we use it correctly. You know, I think that's really what the addiction is about, or the need to connect, because it's so primal. We're so wired to want to connect with other people. Now, those are all the positive things, but there was just a study from London that when you're multitasking, it takes down your IQ 10 points, and it's the equivalent of being stoned. So that's also something to think about. I love this shot because you know that they're getting stoned, right? That's reefer or something in that shot. So I'm going to show you this movie right now. Volume up, hopefully, real high.
I saw the best minds of my generation distracted by texting, emailing, tweeting, dragging their cursors through Google links at dawn, looking for an info fix. Angel-headed hipsters burning for the ultra-fast heavenly connection to the starry dynamo and the machinery of night, who wired and networked and hollow-eyed and caffeinated, sat up searching in the imaginary comfort of Facebook friends, floating across the tops of cities, contemplating signals, who bared their brains to GPS under satellites and saw Wikipedian angels editing on collective knowledge illuminated, who passed through Wi-Fi hotspots with radiant Bluetooth earphones, hallucinating avatars in low-res Second Life islands among the gamers of Warcraft, who were expelled from chat rooms with dreams, with wireless nightmares, megapixels, alcohol, YouTube, and endless eyeballs, who connected via instant messaging in underwear, burning their money on eBay impulse purchases, tapping into the zeitgeist through the synapses of Twitter, who jacked in continuously 70 hours from Pandora to iPod to Amazon to Flickr to Boing Boing, yakety-yacking, primal screaming, unblinking, participating. Unplug! 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 I'm with you in the compulsion to check inboxes, news feeds, and Facebook. Unplug! I'm with you in the addiction and longing for focus. Unplug! I'm with you to cut the umbilical cord of data. Unplug! I'm with you to disconnect from the infosphere. Unplug! I'm with you to power down and revisit the present tense.
Thank you. So that's the film that just, we hope it gets to the next round. Anyways, that was Yelp. So my husband and I co-wrote that, and I made that with my team to kind of explore some of these issues that we explore in a much bigger way in this feature that we're almost done with. So I've shared with you all my fears about technology and my neuroses, and now I'm going to talk to you about where I think it fits historically. You know, when books came out, people thought that we were going to lose our memory. That was the big concern back then. Books are going to destroy your memory. And then, of course, when TV came out, they said, TV's going to make your mind turn to mush. And we've certainly heard what people are saying about the web. Wow, that image is really slowed down. My brother and my father, Leonard Shlain, wrote a lot about literacy. He wrote this, his first book was called Art and Physics, and he made correlations between art and science. And then his other book was called The Alphabet Versus the Goddess, which looked at how literacy rewired the brain. So whenever he goes all throughout history and civilization, whenever literacy was introduced, that it kind of rewired culture to be more left brain, more male and masculine, more patriarchal. And then he talks about how what we're experiencing, or in the 19th century, was this shift towards visual media with photography, cinema, and that it was an iconic revolution that really started to shift us to use more of our right hemisphere, which is associated with the feminine, and that kind of mirrors the rise of women in society. And he recently died. But a lot of his ideas I've been very influenced by about where he looked at how literacy rewired the brain, and I'm really interested in how the internet is rewiring the brain. And I think we're suddenly able to have access to so much data now that we never could have access to. And I love that everyone's been talking so much about collaboration, because the possibility of having access to so much data with so many different perspectives on that data. You can prevent diseases, you can hold governments accountable, you can help people in Haiti after an earthquake, you can do so many things, have creative collaborations as we saw earlier. And this friend of mine who actually was worried, he had an MRI yesterday. He thought he had a brain tumor and he was so worried about this. And he got the MRI back and the doctors were like, it's not a brain tumor. He posted his MRI on Facebook yesterday. And a whole bunch of people commented, and some people found an irregularity that the doctors missed. He is also going to send his MRI to India, where for $30 he can have two brain surgeons also look at the MRI and give a second opinion. I was so blown away by that. So here's all this data. Like, have you guys ever seen an MRI? It's like so much data, you don't even know what to do with it, right? And the doctors, of course, were looking at the specific part for the tumor, and suddenly this MRI is being shot to India to have new perspectives look at it, which I think is just fascinating. So I think we're in this real shift, and I think that I personally, a lot of my creative work comes out of making links and associations, and that's what the internet's all about, is making those kind of associative links. And I think that the social networks, like we said, are providing this kind of glue for these new kinds of experiences. And the internet is also allowing women all over the world to suddenly have access to education from their cell phones. I have a friend who runs a company called Baby Center. And, you know, so many women who don't have access to school, they have cell phones. And she's providing pregnancy information to women in developing countries all over the world who never could have access to it. Just imagine people get degrees on their cell phones if they never had access to it. And just imagine, whenever I love about TED is all these great talks and people have access to them from everywhere. And what if you had the best professors and people all over the world had access to the best professors in any subject? Like, the power and the potential of that is so huge. I think that also we're at this moment in history where, just imagine how, you know, there's 1 billion people connected online in just about 14 years. And just, it's not going to be long before all of us are connected online. And the potential for collaboration for that, and the potential for different perspectives and solutions to all these problems that we've created, that humans have created, I think the way out of it is that we're suddenly going to be able to tap into this collaborative consciousness and problem solving if we are open sourced about it, and if we truly believe that this can take us to the next level in humanity. I am trying to skip through because I had a longer talk than is allowed here. The other TED talk I gave was 18 minutes. This is 10. Okay. So I think that the internet has finally provided the world with a central nervous system. And that is what we're seeing today. And we're beginning to look for the links and see the links. And I think if we can just focus on that, it's the trailer for our movie. Louder. We're almost done. We're like 3 weeks away from finishing. to be done by the end of the year. It's called Connected, a Declaration of Interdependence. And we explore a lot of the stuff we've been talking about here, but for 75 minutes. So Sophocles said, nothing vast enters the life of mortals without a curse. And I think if we can just kind of control the curse part and focus on the vastness of what we could all do together, if we could just channel it and use it for collaboration, I think we're headed for a very exciting time. Thank you.